Freight Train, number 22, jamming for Houston against number 1987 Shark Week team captain for the Boston Massacre. There's the first whistle. Freight Train looking for that inside line. Dodges to the outside. Gets around Dixie. Kicks on the outside. Held up. Oh, runs into Vixen DeSmacchia. Vixen DeSmacchia moves her to the inside, but she slips through and gets out front for lead jammer. Shark Week heading to the penalty box already. It looks like 2x4, I believe. 2x4s in the penalty box for Houston. So it's a 4-on-3, 4-on-3 pack advantage for the Boston Massacre. But now Houston on the power jam. Freight Train leaning into it. Gets around Vixen to hit ya. And comes out with the first grand slam of the game. 5 points on the board for Houston. And just like that, right around. Houston playing the passive offense. Now Freight Train leaning into it, trying to live up to her name. But Boston Massacre holding their own. Now that's living up to her name. Gets around Vixen to hit ya. And Maya Mangalyu, number 1111, unable to stop her. And that's another grand slam. 10 points so far for Houston. And the Pack still in turn one. Freight Train leaning in once again. Boston Massacre trying to match her move, just surround her. Vixen to smack in. Dixie kicks up front with a two wall. Vixen to smack you, drops back in. Dixie kicks, runs out of room. Another grand slam for Houston. 15 points for the ladies in white. Houston in the white. Boston Massacre in the blue. Fourth scoring pass for Freight Train of Houston. And now opting to call off the jam just as Shark Week gets out of the penalty box. And two more points for Houston, so it looks like a big jam right off the bat for the ladies in white.
A great start for Houston, and of course here we have Freight Train, a new addition to the Houston Roller Derby team. Houston has said that she's really made a difference on their team, and obviously she's showing here what it's going to take on the track for her to put up a lot of points.
Space Invader, number 1978, is going to jam next for Boston Massacre against number 9, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly. And Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, about 5'4", I think. But let's see what if she's got the stuff to back up her name. Space Invader up front, gets around Miss Stilla, number 16, to break out for lead jammer. But there's Big Bad Voodoo Dolly with a big burst of speed around the outside of the pack. And she completes her initial pass, but Space Invader moving into the pack on her first scoring pass. Looks like an opening, but no. Brandy Brown screens across with a hip check, knocking down Space Invader. She calls off the jam from the ground.
I see 0 points for Houston. I'm still looking for points for Boston, and it looks like two.
So Boston on the board.
Yeah, Boston on the board, really tight jam. Again, I'm seeing these fast packs I've been seeing all day here at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza. Fast packs, tight games. See if Boston can make up that power jam from the first jam. And if I'm not mistaken, we are getting an official timeout. All the official timeouts here at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza are sponsored by Wicked Skatewear. Wicked Skatewear is the official timeout sponsor here for the evening. And it looks like it is already an official review for Boston.
Now I see Space Invader, number 1978. She was the jammer in the previous jam and now sitting in the penalty box. So that may have something to do with the official review, but we will, of course, wait for an update if one comes along.
If we get an update up here, we listen down there. Oftentimes our announcer referee down there helps us out.
But so far, a very tough game. Houston has had a huge jam, of course, a power jam in the very first jam, and Freight Train was just able to bash her way through three times, and then got two more points. That's where that 17 points came from, the very first jam. And, of course, this jam where Space Invader ended up in the penalty box, she did catch 2 points off the back of the pack before calling it off.
Yeah, we see Coach Justin Drescher there in the middle right now, the designated alternate for the Boston team, waiting to see what the officials are going to decide about what he's asked them to do. I haven't seen the Houston bench inside, but the designated alternate for Houston is Spanky. That's what they told me it was earlier. I could be incorrect. Spanky and Chicken, as opposed to Justin Drescher and Kevin Up on the Boston bench.
I just like the name Spanky.
The folks at home could not see the look that was on your face. It was really delightful. We're going to have a fun bout to call here. And it looks like Spanky has come in to participate in this official timeout.
I'm surprised there aren't more Derby folks named Spanky.
And that is, it looks like our head ref this evening on rink three is Noel Peter ref. He's talking about what the officials have decided to the captains. And that is a very disappointed look on Coach Drescher's face. I think we're going to see Space Invaders stay in the penalty boxes, is my guess, if that's what they were reviewing. It was obviously not a great decision for Boston.
Seems likely, but Space Invader in the penalty box, so it's going to start out with a power jam for Houston. Syringe, number 911, jamming. Houston in the white, Boston Massacre in the blue. There's the first whistle. Syringe driving straight up the middle. Crazy Dukes and Dottie Danger and Vixen to Smakia, three wall. Now it's a two wall. Crazy Dukes and Vixen to Smakia trying to hang on. Crazy Dukes trying to reel her in, but a burst of speed takes Syringe out of the pack, and she's lead jammer. Now Houston moving in. Jekyll and Heidi trying to break up that wall of the Boston Massacre. And now Syringe driving straight up the middle, gets caught in the front by Crazy Dukes, number five, but drives her way around. And it's a grand slam for Houston again, a very familiar sight. This is, of course, the third jam, but the second power jam for Houston. Syringe into the pack again. Second scoring pass for her. Gets up to a four wall. Dottie Danger gets position on her, slows her down, but Syringe breaks through, calls off the jam. Another grand slam, 10 points in this jam.
Well, Houston off the bat here with a couple of power jams, two out of the first three jams, catching power jams. We did get a confirmation that Boston was both confirming points and penalties. Of course, with our new rule set now, they can ask for unlimited things during the time they're in the middle doing an official timeout, an official review on the penalties. So they have apparently went and clarified two things.
Number 360, the Angie Christ in the penalty box for Houston, so they're going to be down one blocker, but a four-on-three pack disadvantage, but Freight Train back in the star. She drives her way up to the front, beats her way past Shark Week, team captain of Boston Massacre, and gets lead jammer. Freight Train around again. Shark Week makes first contact. Lois Carmen Dominator can't stay in front. Shark Week has to let her go, and it's a grand slam. First 5 points in this jam. Space Invader out of the penalty box, breaks through the pack, almost reeled back in by, is that the prosecutor? No. Oh, Brandy Brown, number 26, but jam called off by Freight Train. Did she pick up any more points?
Yeah, she picked up another 4 points. Yeah, so a 9-point jam for Freight Train to match with her 17-point jam we started out. 26 points on the board just for her. We have a Little Pain, number 451 for Boston, number 9, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly jamming for Houston. And the pack is off, and it is Boston for lead jammer right out of the pack. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly getting a little bit of trouble. A nice knockout by number 43, Ginger Kid.
Little Pain, number 451, is lead jammer for Boston Massacre. But Big Bad Voodoo Dolly making her way around into scoring position, trying to match those points, but Lil Payne breaks through. 4 points for Boston. She raises a fist in the air in victory, but still got a little ways to go to catch up to Houston.
Boston needs every point they can get. That, tripled the points they had on the board, that about 6-37 right now, and we have 24 minutes remaining in this first period. It looks like number 78, Space Invader, on the jammer line, along with a number 911 from Houston, Syringe.
Official timeout right now. It looks like, yes, official timeout.
All official timeouts, of course, are sponsored by Wicked State Mirror. You can find them here if you happen to be streaming or you want to come in tomorrow. You'll catch them near the beer booth in the middle, in between rinks 2 and 3. It appears the officials are working something out on their own right now as well. And we're getting underway.
And number 1978, Space Invader, of course, jamming for Boston against number 911, Syringe.
Oh, they're fixing the time on the board here.
Time adjusted to just over 24 minutes. Space Invader gets knocked out by Prosecutor, held in the back, moving up the outside lane. But that is Syringe getting out first for lead jammer for Houston. Up front, Space Invader behind Death by Chocolate dodges around her. Both jammers moving into scoring position. Syringe hits the pack, drives to the inside, but Haley Contagious forces her out of bounds. Space Invader gets into the pack, and the jam called off. No points for Boston.
No points for either.
Possibly 1 point for Houston. They're at 37 points now.
Yes, 1 point for Houston. You're absolutely correct, Bulldog. 1 point for Houston. It is a tight game. We have Shark Week out there jamming for Boston, and Boston, of course, only getting two lead jams out of these first seven jams. That's got to be a tough way to get points on the board.
Shark Week driving up the inside, gets around number 19, Betty Watchett. And she is lead jammer, very behind her Freight Train, breaking out of the pack as well. About a quarter of a lap separates the two jammers. The Shark Week hits the pack, but immediately comes to a stop. Betty Watchett putting an end to that scoring pass. 1 point as Shark Week calls off the jam.
That brings them up, Boston up to a big 7-37 for Houston. 22:40 remaining in the period, and we are seeing, if I'm not mistaken, another official timeout. This official timeout is brought to you by Wicked Skatewear, the official sponsor of all official timeouts here at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza.
Wicked Skatewear definitely getting their money's worth for their sponsorship so far in this first half.
In this bout, I think this is more official timeouts than I've seen in all the bouts that I've called this weekend. There's just been a couple tough little things. It's not anything special with the crew. It just happens to be how this bout is going right now for them. And it's got to be hard for the skaters with the interruptions to just not really get this bout going for this.
So Freight Train reporting to the penalty box as jammer. So that's going to be a power jam for Boston. I believe only the second power jam for Boston. Is that accurate?
Yes, that would be the second power jam for Boston.
Thank you, Amy Jo, the statistician for this bout.
Well, actually, I have to say I didn't keep track of power jams for Boston, but I think you are correct, Bulldog. I have to rely on my memory.
I'm just going to pretend like you know everything, so just agree with whatever I say. Here's Maya Mangleyu jamming for Boston on the power jam. She is lead jammer and now hits the pack on her first scoring pass. Runs right into the Houston. They immediately surround her and just drive her back and forth, but she forces her way through the turn and does a spin move around through Death by Chocolate, claiming a grand slam for Boston. That puts them into double digits as Maya Mangleyu hits the pack again. And first contact goes to Brandy Brown, driving her to the outside. Now it moves around to Patty Payne. That was Becky Booty. Excuse me, 866. Becky Booty made last contact, but Maya Mangleyu getting another grand slam for Boston. Now a third scoring pass, but Freight Train now back in action, of course, on her initial pass. There's Maya Mangleyu going one-on-one with Becky Booty. Becky Booty stumbles, moving into turn three, and Maya Mangleyu completes that third grand slam for Boston. Freight Train in the pack, still on her initial pass, and Boston holding her back. All four of the skaters, Lois Carmen, Dominator, and Shayna Nestor, still in front, but Freight Train manages to get through. But here's Maya Mangleyu on yet another scoring pass. I believe fourth scoring pass in this jam. Knocked out of bounds by number 26, Brandy Brown, and calls it off. Going to get one more point for Boston. I believe that was a 16-point jam.
Was he only holding up 1 point?
It was
16
one?
Or 17. To me, it looked like two. It's a little tricky to tell.
24 points showing on the scoreboard for Boston.
That would be a 17-point jam to add to their seven.
Yes.
And I think we had a real hard time. Freight Train, not used to coming out of the box to approach the pack. She took a little longer to get through the pack than she has any other jam she's been out there.
All right, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, number 9, jamming for Houston. But all the way up front, it is that Dottie Danger? No, that is Lil Payne, number 451. Lil Payne jamming for Boston. And she gets out first for lead jammer. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly was speeding around the outside, gets past Crazy Dukes and completes her initial pass. But here is Lil Payne on a scoring pass, squeezing right between 2x4.
And she takes every point she can get. That's three more points for Boston. They've got at least the last three jams here. It looks like Boston's finally got their groove. What did you see that has you laughing, Bulldog?
Oh, it was not between 2x4, as in 2x4s. It was 2x4 and Betty Watchett, number 19.
Well, that is number 911 jamming Syringe for Houston in white, 1978 Space Invader in blue jamming for Boston.
And the penalty box empty, so it's 5-on-5 right now. Syringe looking for that outside lane, but Vixen to Hitcha drives her to the inside, and they both go down. They're at the back of the pack. Up front, there goes Space Invader through the pack and claiming lead jammer for Boston. So Boston coming back with a vengeance, very steadily closing that gap. Houston has not scored very many points in the last few jams, and Syringe looking to change that, but Space Invader has just shy of getting that jammer point, but completes her first scoring pass, calls off the jam. Syringe not going to get around in time.
Yeah, Boston has managed to keep Houston scoreless, 2-3-4 for the last four jams. This is a real change. Of course, Houston coming out strong in the beginning with that big power jam and putting the 17 points on the board, and now Boston chipping away on it. Just taking this slow approach, and we look like we have a team timeout for Houston.
That's right, team timeout taken by Houston. Houston seeing Boston coming up very quickly, and they probably want to check their game plan and make sure, you know, take away that momentum from Boston. Just slow them down a little bit. You know, they're running hot. Let them cool their engines a little bit.
And I think the one thing that Houston is going to find here is while they are not at the Shriners in Boston, the Boston fans are kind of the 15th skater on the roster here. They are loud. They cheer. They are organized. They have a cheer for every jammer. They have a cheer for every blocker. They do Boston, Boston, pinch, pinch, pinch. We can't really hear that on the feed up here, but these fans are going to be getting into the battle, and it's really going to drive this battle a little bit.
Okay, that was a quick team timeout. Maya Mangle, you number 1111, jamming for Boston against number 22, Freight Train. And we are down one skater for Houston. So it's going to be 4-on-3 back advantage. Maya Mangle-Yu gets around her teammates, runs into the three wall, gets around Angie Christ. Angie Christ drops back to bridge. Betty watch it, and Jekyll and Heidi unable to stop her. Maya Mangle-Yu is the lead jammer. Freight Train stuck in the back of the pack. Shayna Nestor back and forth, holding her, now knocking her down, moving into turn three. She has to recycle all the way back out of turn three. Now moving in, Shayna Nestor and Anorexia with a two-wall that's LCD, Lois Carmen Dominator. Guarding the inside, but Freight Train able to sneak through. But there's Maya Mangle-Yu on a scoring pass, moving up to the front. Slowed down a little bit, but is able to burst through and does get all 5 points.
That was a really pretty mohawk around the skater. Even though her shoulders were behind the skater, she brought her hips around the front to get that last 5th point, a 10-point jam for Mangle. And we were just not used to seeing Freight Train get stuck in the pack like that. As she was in the beginning of this bout, she was just busting through. So a huge change and a lead change here on the scoreboard, 41-37, Boston over Houston, 17-32 remaining in the period.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, number 22, Freight Train, aptly named. And I think Boston has actually come up with the strategy of just slowing her down. Don't let her get too much momentum, because once she gets moving, she's very hard to stop. But there's Big Bad Voodoo Dolly putting on some speed, but just edged out by Lil Payne, number 451, jamming for Boston. But she does get lead jammer. No, she did actually edge out Lil Payne, and she is lead jammer in control of the clock. But it's not looking like she's going to call it off. Looks like she's going to let the game go. No. Okay, there it is. Calling off the jam, but a little late. You have to say. Lil Payne, Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, maybe a little mental error. She let Lil Payne get into the pack and score some points, then called it off. And she wasn't anywhere near the pack to match them.
Yeah, a 3-0 jam for Boston. You know, Houston getting their first lead in 6 jams, but didn't take advantage of it. See if Boston goes back to, they are still keeping Houston scoreless.
Yeah, I think honestly the first technical mistake I've seen Houston make. They've committed some penalties and played short shifted, but I haven't seen them make technical mistakes until now. But right now Boston in the lead. We have had a lead change, and there's Space Invader jamming once again for Boston. And right behind her, Syringe taking the star again up to the front. Dixie kicks with a big shoulder check, takes her out in turn one, and drops back, forcing Syringe to recycle. And there goes Space Invader into the back on a scoring pass. Dodges around two by Force, gets up to the front, dodges around the Angie Christ, and completes the pass. Only four out of potential five. Did not get all 5 points. But she's around again. Space Invader into the pack. Second scoring pass. There goes Syringe, completing her initial pass now. And Space Invader opting to call off the jam. Of course, Syringe still far away, but...
Picking up only two points for a total of 6 point jam. Boston is on a 44-0 run so far, mostly due to lead jammers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lead jams in the last 7 jam, and the one they gave up, they still kept them scoreless and scored themselves.
Well summarized. There it is. And there's a freight train once again against Maya Mangalyu, number 1111. Freight Train finds an easy opening on the inside. Just a little chink, a little break in Boston's armor, and Freight Train bursts through. She is lead jammer. Maya Mangalyu making him run around the outside. Gets caught up front by number 16, Mistilla, but breaks through. Here comes Freight Train, though, on a scoring pass. Runs into Ginger Kid. Ginger Kid driving that shoulder in. She's backed up by Shayna Nestor, but goes wide, calling off the jam.
And we're seeing a blocking out of bounds call sending one of the Houston skaters to the box. The box is a little fuller than we've seen it in a while. I can't all tell who went to the box for what. We'll get the update on the Ringster stats, but it looks like we have two Houston skaters, one Boston blocker, so a slightly leaner pack as we get here into this next jam.
Looks like Becky Booty, number 866, and number 26, Brandy Brown, in the penalty box for Houston. And it looks like Dixie kicks in the penalty box for Boston. So 4-on-3 pack advantage. And there goes number 451, Lil Payne. She's lead jammer.
And Death by Chocolate still stuck in the pack.
Oh, Death by Chocolate having a skate malfunction. It looks like, it looks like her skate, her toe guard might be a little loose. My eyes could be playing with me, but... Or maybe not. Looks like she's skating all right now. Apparently no technical malfunction. Death by Chocolate still on her initial pass. Up front, trying to get around Shark Week. Shark Week with some vicious, that was almost vicious booty blocking with a little bit of hip checking mixed in. But Boston calling off the jam and winning yet another jam.
Yeah, no points, though. Oh. On that pass.
Oh, so it was a tie. You're right.
Yeah. 55 for Boston, 39 for Houston. We're past the halfway point. We're going to drop below 13 minutes before we get this next jam underway. And Boston continuing to dominate these lead jam calls and keeping a tight, tight game.
And making her debut on the jammer line, it's Ginger Kid, number 43 for Boston. And a familiar face, number 911, Syringe, is jamming for Houston. Houston in the white and pink, Boston in the blue and white. Ginger Kid driving ahead and breaks out of the pack. She's lead jammer. Oh.
And Houston's jammer is now in the penalty box. Power jam for Boston.
Ginger Kid on her first scoring pass and still on the power jam. She's dropped back by Becky Booty, fresh from the penalty box. And now Becky Booty all over the track, matching every move. But Ginger Kid with a quick move up the inside, gets up now. Brandy Brown, number 26, and Mistilla teaming up, holding her back. But Ginger, excellent move. That's number 859, Shayna Nestor, just broke up that three wall and opened up the inside door for the Ginger Kid. And she's going to get their first scoring pass.
It's a little short packed out there for Boston with only two. The last time around for Ginger Kid, they were helping break up these walls, doing a little more active offense, but it looks like now that Haley and her partner out there on the track are down to two, they really can't get involved and lose that position.
However, Becky Booty and Mistilla able to slow down Ginger Kid and force her to work for those points. And here comes Syringe, number 911, jamming for Houston out of the penalty box. Ginger Kid held up by all four Houston blockers. Patty Payne's making contact at the back, and Syringe finds the wide open outside lane, courtesy of having only two Boston blockers on the track. Ginger Kid knocked down by Becky Booty and now desperately calling off the jam. Did she do it in time? No points for Houston. And it looks like 3 points for Boston on that one?
It looks like 3 points for Boston. She had an earlier scoring pass, I believe. That was a lot of work there for Ginger Kidd in that jam. A lot of work. The Houston defense was simply amazing, even with an active offense from the Boston in that earlier pass. They just really held her back. That was a fantastic penalty burn for Houston. Looks like Spanky came in to try to clarify something. We're not going to get an official timeout. We're going to get it on the way with our pack at the pivot line.
And Dottie Danger in the penalty box for Boston. That means that it's a 4-on-3 pack for Houston. Freight Train knocked down just as she got out of the pack, but the referee did not declare her lead jammer or indicate that she had not gotten it, so she did not cleanly break the pack. That means that it's still an open opportunity, and there's Maya Mangalieu getting out of the Houston pack and claiming lead jammer.
I think it was a little tough for Freitching. She might have passed those hips, but she wasn't skating when she passed those hips.
That's right. She was not in control. She was stumbling just before she passed the front of the pack. But now...
There's 2 minutes for Freight Train going to the penalty box. It looked at first like a cut track, but I think it was still signaled a forearm and misconduct. Insubordination, thank you.
That's right. She sassed the referee and gets to the extra minute. So that is very bad for Houston. They really need that jammer. And that is also two more penalties towards getting ejected. Now, only 7 penalties allowed, and then you are ejected for excessive penalties. But right now, on the power jam, Boston's Maya Mangalieu gets into the pack but driven out of bounds by Mayhem Angelou. That's Maya Mangalieu knocked out by Mayhem Angelou of Houston.
Those are tricky. You're doing a great job with that, Bulldog.
I think they do that on purpose.
Yeah, this is going to be the third minute here for Freight Train already, with 9 minutes remaining in the period. And it looks like number 360, Captain the Antichrist, is having a little conversation with Noel Peter. And we are going to call an official timeout for an official review called by Houston. All official timeouts are sponsored by Wicked Skatewear. Wicked Skatewear is the official timeout sponsor of the East Coast Derby Extravaganza. I can only imagine that there may be some discussion about the second minute. We're speculating. I'm sure that our crack production crew will get us some more information to get back out to you people listening to us. Do feel free to talk about the bout here on the hashtag talk to the WFTDA.
Talk to WFTDA. That's TALK, the number 2. WFTDA. Talk to WFTDA. That is the hashtag.
And we are getting, it is actually a clarification. Freight Train's initial penalty was a cut track, but then she also did get the insubordination minute.
Don't sass the refs.
I'm looking at an N on Frinkster, which has me confused. I wasn't aware of that particular code, so I think there's been some changes in the paperwork, possibly. And now, earlier I was talking about the fans down here, about how Boston just gets into the game. And another thing that they really love to do is they recruit everyone around them to be a Bostonian for the day. And we've been told they've managed to recruit Megatron from Derby Deeds to even get into their cheering down here on corner three.
That's right. He's found himself some blue and white tulle to wear.
Tulle?
That's a T-O-U-L-E, I believe.
Oh, okay. I'm not seeing what you're talking about, and so my brain came up with ideas about what a tulle might be that he's wearing.
It's the frilly material worn by ballerinas.
Oh, okay.
And Megatron.
I would just call that a tutu.
Yes, that's what a tutu is made of. Sure, you want to go get technical on me.
Well, most people wearing a tulle around their waist are often referring to something other than a tutu. This is quite a discussion here between the captains here and Noel Peter Ref. He seems to be doing a very animated job of explaining what's going on, and it does seem to be directed towards the Houston bench. Of course, Houston really suffering here is 77-39. The clock has stopped at 8:55 in the first period.
And it looks like number 55, Bad Person, giving Space Invader some dancing lessons. Probably preparing for the after party, but, you know, it is definitely a little early to celebrate. Right now, 77 points for Boston, 39 points for Houston, and in fact, most of those points for Houston scored in the very first jam by Freight Train on a power jam. Now, we're just under 9 minutes left in the first half of the game, and Boston looking like they were just going to get run over by a Freight Train, you might say, but now leading the charge, well ahead of Houston as we are getting close to the end of the first half. Oh, Space Invader with a, we have a minimal pack, two blockers from each team in the penalty box, so 2-on-2 on the track. Space Invader gets a cutting the track, and that is, we may have our first jammer swap out.
We may. I'm not quite sure how long Freight Train was in the box. If she has less than a minute left, we may see her coming out. Instead, she's getting a minute reduction in her time out here, Bulldog.
And that's right. So it looks like she only had about a minute and a few seconds left in her penalty. So you are absolutely correct. That was a minute reduction. Now, both jammers back on the track just like that. So that sass has just been counteracted by Space Invader's penalty. But Space Invader getting through the pack, but that counts as her initial pass. She got that penalty while she was still on her initial pass. And now lead. Now that's confusing. I thought Space Invader... Oh, excuse me.
Space Invader did not get lead. No, you're all right. Talking about, I know we all get confused because we've seen Space Invaders out there so many times. No, it was her initial pass.
It was him signaling the penalty, and I at first mistook it for lead jammer.
It was easy to do because it's hard to see on such a short view of this front side straightaway. It kind of looked like she came in behind, but clearly we couldn't see. Houston had challenged the insubordination call either, but it was ruled to stand. So that's 2 minutes penalty. Stood. We saw that happen here. She got a reduction, though.
That was that official timeout. Now Lil Payne, number 451, jamming for Boston, way in the back. But Big Bad Voodoo Dolly getting sent to the penalty box on a cutting the track. So another power jam. Houston giving up the power jams repeatedly. Boston's jammers now skating relatively much cleaner than the Houston skaters. They've been getting lots of power jams, and now Lil Payne is the lead jammer coming around on her first scoring pass. Becky Booty in position. Prosecutor coming across with a hip check. Now squeezing together. Becky Booty and Prosecutor holding the line, and up front, I believe that is Betty Watchett, number 19, in the front guard position. That was that little triad position that we see so often these days. But Lil Payne able to break through. She gets all 5 points and comes around. The pack has not moved from the starting positions pretty much. Lil Payne knocking down Betty Booty, gets around Prosecutor, and Betty Watchett not able to get in her way. Another grand slam, Boston.
It almost looked like Lil Payne indicated herself, calm down, be prepared, focus on this as we approach, and as she was getting ready for this next scoring pass.
Big Bad Voodoo Dolly is out of the penalty box, making her way around, but has to recycle all the way back to turn four. Gets around Shayna Nestor as Lil Payne completes her another scoring pass, another grand slam. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, of course, I believe on her initial pass still. I believe she got that penalty on her initial pass. But now making a valiant effort through the pack. But Lil Payne through the pack, another scoring pass, but gets knocked down by the prosecutor, but did not go out of bounds. So picks herself back up and gets through the pack and gets another five. She did pass Big Bad Voodoo Dolly again in the pack. And now Big Bad Voodoo Dolly not going to get any points, but great effort forcing the jam. At least no points for Houston. But Boston didn't get another scoring pass.
Boston now on a 94-2 scoring run. Just these two teams, I expected a much closer bout here early on. It's just been, teams are even in the penalties, but Houston has been racking up the jammer penalties. And Boston has been keeping their jammers for the most part out of the box.
I think the key right there. Now it's number 911 Syringe jamming for Houston. And Maya Mangalyu, held up by Death by Chocolate, almost stumbles but manages to get up the inside and claims lead jammer. Syringe still in the pack. Stuck behind Shark Week and Vixen to Hitcha. Oh, Shark Week drops out of bounds, and Vixen Ahitya can't hold on. There goes Syringe out of the pack, both jammers moving into scoring position. But Boston in control of the clock with Lee Jammer. Now wide open outside lane. Death by Chocolate moves in, but not enough. Maya Mangalyu calls off the jam. 4 points, and Houston comes up empty once again.
Well, that's going to move that up to a 98-2 scoring run for Boston. There's 2 points just a couple jams ago. They are getting lead jam after lead jam after lead jam and putting Houston's jammers in the box. Plus, they've been having this amazing back bridging as the jammers are coming out of the box. A lot of the newer teams are very used to forward bridging, but we see orchestrated back bridging to really pull it back and the start at the pivot line.
Freight Train back on the line. Ginger Kid making her second appearance on the jammer line, but Freight Train busts through and claims lead jammer for Houston. Ginger Kid, quick move around the outside, gets her past the Houston guards and completes her initial pass about a half a lap behind Freight Train as she moves into a scoring pass, gets through the pack, calls off the jam. 4 points for Houston. They've doubled the amount of points they've scored in, I think, the last, how many jams? Ten jams or something.
Yeah, I've lost track, I have to tell you, Bulldog. I've lost track. That was what we were seeing early on out of Freight Train. Hopefully she's got these three penalties out of her mind and is back into her regular form, because Houston really needs this to stay in the game.
That's right. Houston has only scored 6 points since Boston was at 7 points. So it's been just an enormous scoring streak by Boston. Lil Payne back in the jammer cap. And there goes Death by Chocolate jamming for the first time for Houston, and a quick move up the inside. Actually, second time jamming, I think, for Houston. But she gets lead jammer. Lil Payne behind her, about a quarter lap behind. Death by Chocolate very fast through the pack, tries to make a slalom run, but Anorexia and Shayna Nestor managed to shut the door on her, forcing the call off.
A 2-0 jam for Houston. Death by Chocolate just seeing that nice little opening coming into corner one on the inside. And it wasn't actually little. It was huge. It was almost half the track. Boston had moved to the outside. An unusual thing for these Boston packs to allow for the Houston jammers.
All right, Houston trying to put together some kind of momentum, but only 2 minutes left in the first half. Maya Mangalyu up front, the Angie Christ, the only thing between her and daylight, going back and forth, but the Angie Christ holding tight, looks like Betty Watchett bridging, and Angie Christ almost driving her back into the loving positional block of Betty Watchett, but Maya Mangalyu able to break through Glitz Lee Jammer, but that bought some time for Houston, and now Brandy Brown on her debut gets into the pack. Oh, it's perfect timing by Maya Mangalyu. Calls off the jam, gets all 4 points. Brandy Brown coming up empty.
I would not have wanted to have been Houston's jam ref on that one. That was like a nose over the finish line on that fourth whistle. The fourth whistle getting called very fast. Houston comes up short with nothing.
That's right. The nose doesn't count. It's the hips.
You're right. Thank you very much, Bulldog. I'm going to have to use that one now on my... It was by a nose, but not by the hips.
That's right. Now Freight Train back in the star helmet cover for Houston. Ginger Kid, third time jamming, gets dropped way back, almost to turn four by Betty Watchett. Well, Betty Watchett and Becky Booty working together, but now breaks through the pack. But Freight Train on a scoring pass now, just battering her way through the defense, knocks down Vixen DeHitcha and calling off the jam.
Yeah, and we are seeing a couple of... Houston blockers going to the box for out of play calls. That big pullback on Ginger Kid brought them way out of play, and they were not listening to the fact that they were more than 20 feet behind the pack doing that, and it's going to cost them here with a short pack in the next jam.
All right, I believe that was 3 points picked up by Freight Train. Are you just nodding?
I was watching the penalties going. I did not actually see what the score was from the jam refs. There's so much going on here with this activity, with these really high level teams, Division I teams, who are likely to stay in Division I.
And right now, Boston with one blocker in the penalty box, Houston with two, so a pack advantage to Boston. Lil Payne moving into scoring position. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly still on her initial pass, knocked to the outside by Shark Week, has to recycle. And there's Lil Payne dodging around the Angie Christ and gets out. Grand Slam, Boston. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly gets through the pack. A little bit of help from D'Angie Christ to get out, but she is a full lap and a half behind Lil Payne. Lil Payne hits the pack, gets around D'Angie Christ, calls off the jam almost immediately, just going to settle for 2 points on that scoring pass.
Well, settle they can, and it looks like we're coming to the end of this jam, this period.
Are you tired of slipping through slippery corners? Fed up with slipping on slippery surfaces? Introducing the Villain from Radar Wheels. Stride confidently through corners without slipping out. The Villain digs and holds through the corners like no other. Grips on even the worst surfaces. But don't take our word for it.
I hate sliding out. The Villains were so grippy, I felt like I was totally in control. The wheels are really grippy. They were really grippy, but they were still so fast.
Skater approved. The Villain and Villain Wide by Radar Wheels. Order now.
With all the practice, work, fight, sweat, tears, to achieve the next level, it takes a team. Rose City's Wheels of Justice present Derby Days, a badass boot camp. 3 days of skills, drills, and scrimmages coached by Portland's all-stars and special guest. The Wheels of Justice Derby Days. Registration opens June 1st.
We're getting underway here, and that is Lil Payne taking the jammer line against number 69, Death by Chocolate, for Houston.
All right, but we've been seeing strong jamming from Boston all day, and Houston just spending a little too much time in the penalty box, just like you said, Amy Jo. But it looks like Death by Chocolate makes contact with Lil Payne right off the first whistle, but Lil Payne gets around the outside. Oh, but gets caught up by the Houston defense. Jekyll and Heidi drops back to Bridge. And now up front, Becky Booty stumbles, and Lil Payne gets out first for lead jammer. Death by Chocolate still in the pack, stuck behind Shark Week. Drops to the inside. A little help from the Angie Christ screens Vixen to hitch it off. And Shark Week stumbles, Death by Chocolate getting through. But here's Lil Payne on a scoring pass. Stopped and brought to her knees by a shoulder check from Jekyll and Heidi. And calls off the jam before Death by Chocolate can get in there.
She does pick up that 1 point, though. One hard point for the two easy points in the box. So a 3-0 jam for Boston. We saw some really great work from Death by Chocolate. I think what I said before we left the last half, Houston trying a little bit different jammer lineup to see if it would change up the game.
All right, but already penalties accumulating. Looks like two Houston blockers in the penalty box. Looks like Big Bad Voodoo Dolly and Becky Booty in the penalty box for Houston. Anorexia in the penalty box for Boston. But there's Space Invader, number 1978, gets lead jammer. But is that Syringe. Syringe, number 911, breaks free, gets past Ginger Kid. But here is Space Invader on a scoring pass. Miss Stilla, she was decoyed to the outside by Dixie Kicks and left a wide open inside lane. And that's 4 points for Boston.
4-0, keeping Houston scoreless, which they just about did for most of the first period. We are now 122-48 and going into our third jam. I believe I saw Freight Train going to the penalty box as a blocker. That's going to bring her up to 4 penalty minutes. The final, by the way, from Rink 2, if you weren't watching over on the other feed, is 211 Montreal to 168 Charm City. I saw Charm City take an early lead. Clearly that changed before the bout was over.
Number 1111, Maya Mangalieu for Boston, up against number 26, Brandy Brown. Brandy Brown still stuck at the back of the pack for Houston. Maya Mangalieu claiming lead jammer. So, Brandy Brown trying to move up the center, but taken down by Dottie Danger, number 666 for Boston. Now still stuck in the pack as Maya Mangalieu moves up front. The Angie Christ in position, but a quick dodge around the outside, and she gets a grand slam for Boston.
Those are some really beautiful Mohawks. First one direction, then the other direction, and just wove to the back sideways, and she's coming around for another scoring pass.
And what is a Mohawk?
A Mohawk is when you have one foot facing the opposite direction of the other foot.
Okay, just wanted to make sure our folks at home knew exactly what you're talking about.
And she does it again right there. Exactly what she did get around number 360, the Angie Christ from Houston there.
That's right. So pretty when they get it done right. But another grand slam for Boston. Brandy Brown finally breaking free of the pack. That was her initial pass. Two full laps, and now a third scoring pass for Maya Mangalieu, but she just dips into the pack, calls off the jam.
are one for 1 point. No Houston skaters in the box, so a hard-fought 1 point, but that was an 11-point jam. So, you know, here off the beginning, 18 points for Boston, zero for Houston. Boston getting all three lead jams in the first three jams.
All right, so now I haven't seen a single power jam in this second half. So Houston's staying on the track, but Boston's still dominating. Dominating in points and in lead jammer.
It's just the same jammer matchup from the first jam of Lil Payne against number 69, Death by Chocolate. And it's the same result with Lil Payne picking up a lead, but not quite the same result here as far as Death by Chocolate.
Death by Chocolate able to get ahead of Lil Payne. And Lil Payne's just riding the clock right now. She's going to call it out. There it goes.
Without a doubt. A quick 0-0 jam. Boston still keeping Houston scoreless after the first two jams. And frankly, I lost track of how many jams they had left Houston scoreless at the end of the first period. So I think we're just going to start fresh with these counts here in the second period and look to see if Houston can change it up.
Yeah, Houston getting aggressive in their starting positions. They came out and they were fighting for that back line to get right on the jammer line. Syringe lining up against Space Invader. Syringe number 911 in the white for Houston. Number 1978 Space Invader for the blue team, Boston. Now up front, the Space Invader gets stuck behind the Antichrist. Betty Watchett knocks her out of bounds.
And
that's interesting.
Track.
That he calls a cut track, but Betty Watchett gets into the penalty box. He directed her back onto the track. Okay, that got sorted out. Her jam referee was originally signaling cutting the track, but now it's a no pass, no penalty. Did not get that pass for Angie Christ because she got knocked out by Betty Watchett, but there's that first scoring pass. 4 points. Syringe now looking to match those points. She is the lead jammer in control of the clock, so she can potentially match those points and call off the jam for at least a tie, but she doesn't get past the front guard Dixie Kicks. It looks like 2 points for, hook them, no.
Not three. It's Thank really you. Hard to see through the netting sometimes, so we apologize if we aren't always getting the jammer up fingers correct. It looks like 3 points for Houston. First strike on the board for Houston. You were talking about Houston scrambling for that back line, and typically what we see is it often is jammer dependent. The leagues are learning to work with what their jammer's looking for out of them. Some jammers prefer their blockers right there on the jammer line with them. Some really would prefer they take the front, and it's not always easy to get what you want. We are on an official timeout, approved by Wicked Skate Rare.
That's right, and by the Rolling Stones. You can't always get what you want.
Boston actually scoreless in that last jam. That's the first time we've seen that Houston put up points and Boston not put up points.
And looking to keep up that little bit of momentum. And Brandy Brown, number 26, jamming for Houston, makes contact with Maya Angelou. I just love aggressive jammers like that. And that's we're seeing a little bit of that from Boston. Now, it's tricky because if you do that just a fraction of a second too soon before the whistle, that's a penalty and you go straight to the box. But Brandy Brown capitalizes on that tiny advantage and gets through. She's lead jammer, calls off the jam, doesn't get all the way through. How many points did she get, Amy Jo?
It looks like three. 3 points, and she saved that easy target in the box. So a 3-0 jam, that's two lead jams now for Houston. 6 points in the last two jam, bumping it up to 54 points, and Boston holding steady at 133. We have 23-22 remaining in the second period.
And lining up next, Lil Payne, number 451 for Boston. Number 69, Death by Chocolate. DBC, as she's often known, and that's what it says usually says on the back of her jersey. Right now it says nothing, but both jammers diving in neck and neck, shoulder to shoulder, really, for the first couple of seconds of the jam, but Death by Chocolate driven out of bounds by Anorexia. But recovers quickly, gets up to the front. Now it's a three-wall. Shark Week leading the charge for Boston and knocking Death by Chocolate. She steps out just a little bit.
Lead jammer, Boston.
That's right, but Shark Week went out of bounds. And in fact, Shark Week gets the penalty, so now Boston down one blocker. But Lil Payne in control of the clock, just ahead of Death by Chocolate as they approach the pack. Lil Payne not going to chance it. And calls off the jam.
Boston has everything to lose with messing for points at this point in time and burning the clock as much as they can and take advantage of this huge lead they had coming out of the first period. Ginger Kid, number 43, taking the jam line for Boston now. In the white, number 911. Syringe for Houston.
Sorry, Boston looks like they're in good spirits. That was Haley Contagious and Lil Payne doing a little trot step back to their team bench. Ginger Kid, number 43, jamming for Boston. And Syringe back in the jammer star for Houston. Up front, a two-wall up front. Dixie Kicks and LCD, Lois Carmen Dominator. But there it shows. Syringe is lead jammer for Houston. The first time they've gotten out without the Boston jammer right behind them. So, there she goes. Syringe breaks right through the pack very, very easily. Ginger Kid was drawing all of the attention of every single skater in the pack, and Syringe managed to sneak through and does it again, almost does it again, I should say. Bad person made contact with the shoulder, but Syringe, a second scoring pass, almost unnoticed. Everyone focused on Ginger Kid, who is still on her initial pass, and now running into Freight Train. Stuck behind Freight Train, gets around her and the prosecutor can't keep her in. Ginger Kid only completing her initial pass. Syringe coming through a third time, gets through the pack and calls it off. Huge jam for Houston.
14 points there for Houston. You know, started 6 points so far before this jam, and now another 14 points. Kind of surprised Houston didn't play that a little bit longer. They clearly had a pack and a play advantage out there, and they were putting points on the board, but I guess they decided they'd rather keep Boston scoreless in that jam. Ginger Kid, of course, hitting her first time out on the track this period as jammer, and that was a second lead jam for 9/11 Syringe that particular jam this period.
Space Invader number 1978 jamming against Brandy Brown number 26, and the action heating up. Brandy Brown getting a whip off of 2x4, and that takes her out of the pack, and she's lead jammer again for Houston, lead jammer, but this time Space Invader able to get out of the pack and trying to catch up. Just about a third of a lap now, just a few strides behind. Brandy Brown hits the pack, calls off the jam immediately.
I think she was actually calling it off as she was hitting the back of the pack, counting on very fast four whistles. She gets 1 point for it. They have managed to go. Houston has kept Boston scoreless. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6 jams in a row now. Quite a change. It's almost like the reverse of last period, but without all the power jams.
That's right. Boston maybe playing a little bit more conservatively, or Houston just finding some kind of fire. But most importantly, their jammer has not gone to the penalty box. Now, I hope I haven't jinxed them, but now Death by Chocolate, number 69, jamming and leaning into the scrum of Boston. All four skaters holding the line. But now it looks like Shayna Nestor going to the penalty box, and that just leaves a chink in the armor. Death by Chocolate breaking through and getting lead jammer for Houston yet again.
No resistance for Death by Chocolate as she comes through on that backside straightaway, picking up a grand slam.
Maya Mangalyu still in the pack and knocked out of bounds by Miss Stilla, number 16, forced to recycle all the way to turn three as Death by Chocolate comes in for another scoring pass. Contact made by Lois Carmen Dominator. Shark Week guarding the outside, but slips to the inside. Death by Chocolate gets through again. Another grand slam for Houston. Maya Mangalyu having the most trouble with the Houston pack I think I've seen all night. This jam getting almost shut down. She just completed her initial pass. Death by Chocolate on her third scoring pass and breaks through again. Calls off. Not going to get the jammer point, but
another 14 points for Houston. 14, 1 and 14 in the last three jams. That brings them up to 83. They have kept Boston scoreless since the second jam of this period. Boston holding steady at 133 with 18:25 remaining in the period. And it looks like we're continuing with the old lineups who shifted with that one little jam with Ginger Kid. And we are getting a timeout for Boston, I believe. Boston.
I think, to be fair, that was the Houston pack. There was a 5-on-5 jam, and Syringe doing the hard work of getting around, getting those 14 points. And then Death by Chocolate duplicating that effort. Maya Mangalyu, I think for the first time, possibly for the first time, I don't have the numbers right in front of me, but possibly for the first time getting shut out in this game.
Well, she got shut out the last time she was out there. She was playing against number 26,
Brandy Brown.
Brandy Brown. Houston's sticking steady with a three-jammer rotation and just cycling right through them, 69, 91, 26, and repeating it. Boston went and threw Ginger Kid in there in the middle. They were doing also the same three-jammer cycling right through, and it's thrown off the shift, and now Boston seems to just want to take a breath, come back, look at what they were doing, where they changed things up, and, you know, they can't really afford this scoreless and hold at that 133. They had burning time earlier. Time is now starting to no longer be in their favor. So they've stopped this play. We're going to start out again with 451. Lil Payne out there. And 911 syringe for Houston jamming.
Hey, but definitely one thing for sure, Houston has found a fire, and they are burning Boston for the last several jams. Syringe very aggressively into the pack, but knocked out of bounds by Fixin to hit ya. And now stumbles in the middle of the pack, drops back to the rear. Oh, but Lil Payne knocked out of bounds and forced behind Jekyll and Heidi as Syringe breaks free for yet another grand slam for Houston. Lead jammer here.
We are just scoring now. Sorry to interrupt you, Bill Dog. I wanted to put that on here. And you know, Lil Payne just not used to these big pullbacks that she's getting from the Houston pack.
That's right. My brain was saying lead jammer, but my mouth said grand slam. He was holding up and only up one hand and pointing. This is her initial scoring pass, knocked out of bounds by Vixen Tehitcha and drawn back all the way back to the back stretch.
The front and the back of the pack are pretty much mirrored. They're like knocking out and bringing back at the same time. It's really quite fascinating out there.
And now here we are halfway into the jam. It took a full minute for
a 2-0 jam here for Houston. But the last four jams, Houston has had lead. They gave up lead once. They gave up lead once several jams ago, but out of the last seven jams, Houston's had it six times.
That's right. It took a full minute, as I was saying, for Lil Payne to get out of the penalty, out of the pack on her initial pass. So Houston's continuing the streak and continuing on the comeback trail.
Another changeup here with Anya Rexia taking the jammer line for Boston.
And number 26, Brandy Brown, a dodge behind Ginger Kid, gets her out of the pack and lead jammer again. Houston has been so consistent. They are on fire right now.
There was a little bit of a false start from one of the Boston skaters. They didn't catch the skater number she went by, but she had to stay out of the way of Houston's jammer as she was coming back around. And it was 1987 Shark Week, who had got the false start but played it right, heard the warning. It's amazing, frankly, to me that you can hear a false start warning with the excitement here at the East Coast Derby Extravaganza.
Brandy Brown busting into the pack, calling it off for three more points on that last scoring pass for Houston, and Houston almost into double digits.
Yeah, that was 8 points for Houston. I don't think I have that written down quite right, so don't quote me on that. But keeping Boston scoreless again, Boston scoreless since the third jam of this bout, of this period. And 1978 Shark Week back on the jammer line, going back to Boston's normal rotation, 69, Death by Chocolate for Houston.
Death by Chocolate shuffled to the outside by Shayna Nestor, but now manages to burst a speed around the outside, but just ahead of her, 1978 Space Invader. No, Death by Chocolate knocked out of bounds, and is now at the back of the pack, stumbles going into turn three, has to pick herself back up, and now knocked out of bounds by an aggressive shoulder check from Maya Mangalyu as Space Invader into the pack on a scoring pass, gets around Mayhem Angelou, and now up front, Becky Booty unable to stop her. And now, finally, Boston putting some points on the board and in control of the clock with lead jammer. Death by Chocolate knocked to the infield, picks herself back up slowly to get in behind Shayna Nestor. And there's Space Invader up to the front, gets around the Angie Christ, number 360, for a second scoring pass and another grand slam for Boston.
Impressive, staying on the track with that big hit. She's focusing on the center and staying in the middle where she can't get knocked out of bounds and cycling back. That was a second grand slam for Space Invader.
And Death by Chocolate struggling. Boston having found that missing combination they were looking for. Houston with so much momentum, but finally Death by Chocolate on the receiving end. This this time of repeated scoring passes by Space Invader. Third Grand Slam for Boston in this jam, and Death by Chocolate yet to complete her initial pass. Knocked out of bounds by Dixie Kicks, number 1081 for Boston, and has to recycle to turn two. And now a fourth scoring pass by Space Invader up to the front. Now surrounded by Houston blockers, Freight Train getting her hits in, but Space Invader fighting her way through the hard way. Only going to get four out of potential five this time, and Death by Chocolate finally completing her initial pass, but very little time left in the jam. But enough time for Space Invaders to get back in. I believe a fifth scoring pass. Looked like she almost started calling off. Now she's definitely calling it off.
1 second before the 2 minutes would have run out by on its own. She picks up 1 point from my calculations of a 21-point jam for Space Invader. Definitely changed the time. Tied after 9 jams scoreless for Boston. Boston finally puts 21 points on the board. That's more than they put on in the first 3 jams of this period. So they've more than doubled their second period score here.
Big Bad Voodoo Dolly, number 9, jamming for Houston. Houston in the white, Boston Massacre in the dark blue. Lil Payne, 451, jamming, and she gets around the outside, escapes from Betty Watchett, and claims lead jammer. Big Bad Voodoo Dolly around the outside, but gets caught by Ginger Kid and the other one. Maya Mangalyu, number 1111, and she's still in the pack. Knocked to the infield again, this time by I believe 55 Bad Person. Yes. And still in the pack, trying to move up the center. Now a burst of speed takes her, and she gets caught by number 43 Ginger Kid as Lil Payne claims a grand slam against Houston and comes around a second scoring pass. Betty Watchett gets in position, forcing her out of bounds, and she's going to call it off.
I'm waiting for the points for Boston. It looks like 1-6 points for Lil Payne. Boston finally getting back into the getting the lead jammer trend that they need to do to stay on top of this game like they were in the first period. Out of all those 9 scoreless jams earlier, they had lead in one of them. Lead jammer is really what is controlling the score in this bout, Bulldog.
And we haven't seen Freight Train jam very much in this second half. She's actually been blocking more than she's been jamming. Number 26, Brandy Brown, moves around the outside, but gets stuck behind number 103F. That's a Haley Contagious. And that opens the door for Anorexia jamming for Boston to claim lead jammer.
Well, they almost need to keep Freight Train off that track. She's already up to 5 penalties, 5 box trips, and I just don't think they can afford to be having her jamming.
Brandy Brown makes a move around Shark Week, gets past her, but caught by Crazy Dukes as Anorexia gets another grand slam for Boston. But Brandy Brown finally shakes off Crazy Dukes to complete her initial pass, but two laps behind. And now jam gets called off. No points for Houston on that one.
I didn't see the points for Boston, but we're going to see them put up on the board here soon. It is 164 Boston, 94 for Houston. We're just under 11 minutes remaining in this very intense bout between number 24 Boston and number 28 Houston. You know, we've had bouts that have gone back and forth, back and forth, and back and forth that have been close. This bout was a little more run ahead. Still a very intense game, and as much as I hate the phrase of anyone's game, I think what Houston showed for a little while here is they can control the pack, and it could be their game. And still, though, Boston strong.
And that's what they are doing right now. Maya Mangalyu at the back of the pack. Very good control by Houston as Death by Chocolate claims lead jammer. Moving around into scoring position, Maya Mangalyu, very well contained by Houston. Becky Booty holding on with Mastilla and now knocking her down. There's a low block called, but it's on the jammer for Boston. Maya Mangalyu, that means a power jam for Death by Chocolate. But another penalty this time on Ginger Kid. So Boston now down a jammer and a blocker. Pack advantage to Houston. They are at full strength and a grand slam for Death by Chocolate. But she's actually taking her time, maybe a little bit winded. Boston is making her work for those points.
Well, Death by Chocolate might be lucky. She has Freight Train in the pivot cover here on the track for her with Houston. This, from my records, is our first power jam of this second period.
I think you're right. It looks like Miss Stilla going to the penalty box, so that's going to even up the pack, but Death by Chocolate takes off the jammer cap, and now you called it, Amy Jo, Freight Train taking over as jammer, but now running into Shayna Nestor, gets around her, now up to the front, they're facing a two wall up front, but Lois Carmen, Dominator, and Vixen to Hitcha cannot stop her, another grand slam for Houston, and Freight Train now getting some motivation, she's putting some speed around. We were seeing Death by Chocolate looking a little winded, Freight Train not winded at all, she's had quite a break, now Vixen to Hitcha, and Shayna Nestor unable to stop her. Another grand slam. 10 points after the star pass. Freight Train on a roll right now, looking to make it at 3 grand slams on the star pass. Comes around. Ginger Kid comes in at the last second. Hits her, but that's the time runs out. 4 more points for Houston.
Was there any for Boston? No for Boston. That's a 19-point jam for Houston. Houston giving up the lead in that helmet cover pass, but totally paid off as they picked up another 9 points in that jam and still kept Boston scoreless, just running out that 2-minute jam clock. A really smart move out there. Very lucky to be seeing Freight Train in that pivot line. 14-point jams. I wrote an extra 5 down. But still 9 points for Freight Train because of the helmet cover pass.
Well, now Syringe taking over as jammer for Houston. But Boston has their jammer back. Lil Payne, though, at the back of the pack, just trying to make an entrance. Oh, but season opening gets up to the front. Becky Booty, the Angie Christ, number 360, and Betty Watchett in position. Finally run out of room. Lil Payne is going to get lead jammer for Boston. Syringe moving up the outside lane, but dodges around. Dixie kicks, and Haley Contagious tries to catch her, but Syringe able to get out. Both jammers now moving into their first scoring pass. Lil Payne hits the pack first. Looks like she's attempting to call it off, but Syringe might have gotten in there, Amy Jo.
Yeah, these tiny little call-offs on the hip are really hard for the jam reps to read. That's why a lot of times you say, you know, make it big. But it was 2 for Boston, 0 for Houston.
Okay, so just called off in time. Now, it looked like that it took a little bit of time for that. She was in the middle of the pack, so the referees probably had a difficult time seeing that she was making the gesture. But
yeah, you can't see that. You know, blockers are kind of opaque.
They are kind of hard to see through.
And our refs actually don't have X-ray vision.
In spite of what they'll tell you at the after party, Brandi Brown jamming for Houston against number 1978 Space Invader. Space Invader stuck at the back by the prosecutor. It is the prosecutor, not just prosecutor. And Dottie Danger up front, and now Crazy Dukes, the only person in front of Brandi Brown, as she breaks free and claims lead jammer. Space Invader still in the pack, stuck behind. Jekyll and Heidi dodges to the outside, but now gets caught by Becky Booty. It looked like her hand came down and might have given her a little bit of a spank, but obviously by accident. Now up to the front. That is Mayhem Angelou taking down Space Invader with a heavy shoulder, but she gets sent to the penalty box, and Space Invader breaks free. But there she goes, Brandi Brown, getting 4 more for Houston.
4-0 brings Houston to 122, Boston at 166. We have less than 6 minutes remaining in the game. Houston pecking away at this lead. It's going to be tight, but Boston's still really in control. I think we might see if Boston starts to get lead again, we might be seeing a little more time burns out there that we saw earlier in the bout to not push this, not risk penalties.
Number 101, Anorexia. We haven't seen her on it frequently, but this is her third time jamming, according to our... In this period, Anorexia for Boston. But she is stuck in the back of the pack. 2 by Force holding position on her. The Angie Christ now taking up the positional block, but Anorexia dodging back and forth, trying to get out, but forced out of bounds, comes back in clean. Looks like Betty Watchett bridging, but trying to catch up. Now reels her in, and Anorexia is back in the pack. And there goes Freight Train, is lead jammer for Houston. So Houston taking back the momentum. Anorexia looked like she definitely saw daylight, but was unable to quite get past the Angie Christ. Angie Christ, a while back, transferred from Texas. So one of the Texas roller girls from a while back. According to what I was saying.
She transferred from the Executioners. Freight Train, though, a new skater from outside. I guess she's quite the experienced jam skater is what I've been told. She's been on skates since she was 2, Freight Train.
So Jam Skater, she must be good at mohawks.
Very likely. Although I don't think you see a lot of mohawks in jam skating, as much as just a lot of very fast, fancy footwork and keeping your feet moving. Boston certainly has benefited from its share of transfers as well. We see, you know, Crazy Dukes out there came from Providence, Vixen DeHitcha from the Bay State Brawlers. So, you know, they're a newish team, but from some very established skaters in the Northeast region.
That's right, but Houston has narrowed it to only a 40-point game, and now Syringe gets the lead. Jammer and now breaks through a grand slam. Lil Payne struggling to get through once again. Houston seems to have found an answer to Lil Payne, having figured out how to contain this very powerful jammer. She was so strong in the first half, but Houston has found the combination to keep her in the pack. Syringe on a second scoring pass, driven out of bounds by bad person, number 55.
Dex by Chocolate to the box on a very obvious direction of gameplay call there on the backside, so it's going to leave Houston a little short packed starting this closing probably second or third jam to the end here with 3:14 left on the clock. Boston not putting any skaters on the track.
And a little bit of a demonstration from Brandy Brown, who has the jammer star on for Houston.
We haven't hit our 30 seconds yet. I don't see an official timeout. Boston burning as many seconds as they could before they called the timeout. They just stood in the middle and waited to hit for that time to count down. Null Peter, of course, I think being very aware that was going to happen, obviously with not reporting any Boston skaters to track. So a smart move of burning time, but just making sure that they are prepared for this. 166 for Boston, 135 for Houston. We have seen so many games today decided in power jams in the last jam here at ECDX.
That's right, and right now I have to say most of the momentum, Boston has had some strong jams, but most of the momentum in the second half seems to have gone with Houston, and they are feeling it. You can see some good spirits, even, you know, Brandy Brown doing handstands on the jammer line. You don't do that when you're feeling like you're getting knocked around. You know, I think they are feeling the momentum. And, you know, feeling good. And you know what? It is not out of the question for them to catch up. Only 31 points, and they have time for at least two jams in this before the end of the game.
Well, I'm looking here, Bulldog, in the last five jams, 31 points for Houston, 2 for Boston. So you talk about momentum, that's momentum. And 31-2 before this game ends will bring us to a point that I can't quite calculate it exactly, but it will bring the game really close. That would actually leave Boston still winning, but Boston for lead.
But exactly what Houston did not want to happen. Anorexia just burst through the pack and claimed lead jammer right off the get-go. But there goes Brandy Brown breaking free of Dixie Kicks to get out of her initial pass. But here comes Anorexia on a scoring pass. Dodges just to the inside of Becky Booty. Becky Booty had the shoulder but didn't quite close the gap. Anorexia with 4 points. But here comes Brandy Brown looking to match them up front with Shayna Nestor. But now Shayna Nestor running out of room has to give up. And Brandy Brown getting 4 points. But Anorexia getting close to lapping the Houston jammer. Brandy Brown signaling her team to pick up the pace, to push the pack forward and force Anorexia to work for those points. Anorexia, meanwhile, just burning the clock. She's happy, perfectly happy to just match points with Brandy Brown, and she's in control of the clock. She's just going to let this 2 minutes run out. I mean, I don't see any reason for her to call off the jam at this point.
Clearly brilliant coaching from Justin Dreschler on the Boston bench. He told his jammers to go out there and go point for point, although here we have a jammer lap point thrown in there as well. So Boston actually having a positive point differential, they would have been happy with a zero point differential out there, and that is not looking good. Boston does have the opportunity to call this out without taking a penalty.
No, I believe that Anorexia actually got the penalty.
Oh, I apologize. Yes, she does get a back block, and she is hurting.
But we're still going to have, that definitely means we're going to go the full 2 minutes. Anorexia got a nasty fall. I don't know if she got hit, and that's why she's clutching herself, but Ginger Kid knocking Brandy Brown out of bounds, and now forcing her to recycle all the way back to turn four. Brandy Brown, though, going very slow, very casually. You know, I would expect to see a little bit more,
I really like that move from Ginger Kid. She moved back to where she thought she should have gone, and then she wasn't seeing an out-of-play call from any of the back refs, so she went a little further till she saw the out-of-play warning and then moved forward, because she does have to get that warning at that point in time.
Okay, a little bit of a surprise move. Well, originally, I thought it was a timeout for Houston, which makes total sense, but it looks like it's actually Boston called the timeout. Now, this may be the only explanation I can think of, Amy Jo.
Yeah.
It might be an official review.
Yeah, we're seeing some coaches in there in the middle discussing things. We are on an official timeout. And, of course, the Wicked Skatewear sponsoring all of our official timeout. It is Boston requesting an official review, I'm suspecting, of his jammer. Or, you know, here we have the EMTs taking a look at their jammer in the box. So Houston called the timeout. Boston wanted a review is what we're getting here on a clarification for this. Plus, then we also do have the EMTs here in the penalty box. I don't think we'll see another jam start as long as the EMTs are in that space, because it could be dangerous for the EMTs and the skaters.
But, of course, it seems like Boston simply capitalized on the timeout already taken by Houston, right? Houston, of course, wants to stop the clock. That gives them an opportunity to possibly, it buys them enough time that they might actually be able to squeeze two jams out of the remaining 53 seconds.
Yeah, either two jams or enough time to decide if maybe they can pull off this 28-point differential. I've seen it happen. Earlier today, we had Ithaca pull off an 18-point differential coming into the last jam. And the things we have seen out here with the power jams and with whomever gets lead and the power jams have been controlling this. So it is possible. It is just all these little tiny baby steps at the end, all this intensity here on the track between these two coaches. But we are still on an official review.
But the advantage right now definitely to Houston in this last jam, because Boston is going to start the jam with their jammer in the penalty box, a power jam, and that could very well be just enough for Houston to make a big score.
Yeah, we had in that last jam there, we were talking about point for point pass. It actually ended up being 16 Houston to 13 Boston. Of course, slightly influenced by the fact that Boston jammer did go to the box. We don't know what they were looking on down there. To me, it looked like kind of she was clutching her knees. A lot of times when you fall really hard, slides those knee pads down there. Skaters at home know exactly what we're talking about. And it just puts you in a compromised position as a skater that can make those knees hurt. And these jammers here are in really critical moments in this jam. It doesn't look like we have any change in the penalty box. I could be corrected on that.
Well, right now, it looks like the medic's taking a look at anorexia. I just want to make sure. I mean, because it did look like she was hurt, like you were saying.
It does. And this is actually an opportunity here. We don't quite know with the official review. It could be that Boston may choose to change out this jammer. If she's actually injured, they could replace her with a different jammer. And there's enough time expired. Clearly, it's not really an advantage to Boston to do this replacement at this time. They really just want to take care of their skater. We don't know. She's not moving from that chair right now. The EMTs are no longer directly checking her out, but there may be some decision made about swapping her out or deciding to keep her in.
All right, well, the Boston coach moving to the infield, still possibly hoping he can get his jammer out of the penalty box. That could prove crucial in what could be the final jam or the final two jams, depending on how things unfold.
Yeah, but I'm not actually sure, now that I'm looking at the situation down there, we don't know for sure what they're talking about. I wouldn't expect the head ref, Noel Peter, to discuss with the rest of his referees about allowing that change. So with the referees having some discussion, apparently other things are going on. We see Noel Peter coming out, talking to outside pack refs, talking with his inside pack refs and Jan refs. There's clearly a lot of activity going on down there. The coaches wanting to get everything right and give every last ounce out of this game that they can in any way they can.
But at this point, we're starting to sound like one of those 24-hour news channels. We know nothing, and we're going to spend the next 15 minutes explaining that to you.
It's about how it goes, but it's nice to explore the possibilities of what could be going on down there on the track. It's a complicated game, and these are top-notch coaches here. They obviously have to be with these Division I teams out there. They know how to manage their players and how to manage their games and how to make the officiating work for them as best they can within the rules.
All right, but right now, Houston, look who's got the jammer star.
Yeah, that's Freight Train. Houston has apparently found new confidence in Freight Train here at the end of the second period. She has done well for them. Freight Train, 4 points the last time that she was out. And, of course, she took a jammer pass earlier. I didn't mark down which one, but I remember seeing she picked up 9 points for her team. So she's doing some good things in there. She hasn't picked up another penalty since we mentioned way back when that she was at five. She does seem to be the most penalized skater of this bout right now, though.
Right, but now if she had six, they might not field her. But since she has five, if she had six, if she went to the penalty box, even if there was time left after she served her penalty, they would not let her back onto the track. She would not be able to return. So that would mean that any penalty to Freight Train would, in effect, be the end of the jam.
End of scoring possibilities for Houston, for sure.
But since she only has five, she can actually get sent to the penalty box, and if there's time, she can actually get back in. So, I mean, it's a little something, but really, I don't think they want her to go to the penalty box at all.
Well, Houston has an advantage here, starting with the power jam, of course, but they do have a huge pack disadvantage.
All right, well, I don't see any changes in the penalty box. So now this jam starts. Freight Train going back and forth with Boston, looking very determined. Maya Mangalyu knocking her to the inside, but Freight Train just moving right through her. But now up to the front end, slips through that opening opened up by number 16, Miss Stella of Houston. Houston, of course, in the white, Boston Massacre in the dark blue. And Freight Train is the lead jammer, and that is the first step that they need to do. That was a must do. They had to get lead jammer, and now Freight Train on her first scoring pass. Shark Week in position on her. Now Freight Train dodging to the inside, but Shark Week matches, and now forces her to the outside. Freight Train almost got around, and now moves up to the front and calls off the jam.
Yeah, the clock was the biggest thing going on in the play out there. She called that with 12 seconds remaining on the clock. We saw on the computer, this, of course, is not our official clock, but they were watching that clock as much as they were watching any other skater on the track pick up as many points in this particular pass, in this particular jam, put out a fresh jammer. They've had enough time to be talking about things on their benches, and so they really used that time off wisely, picked up a few points. I'm looking at 6 points on the board since I last wrote down the score. I think somehow 6 points for Freight Train. That jam moved it to 157 for Houston to 79 Boston. That's at 22 points.
Which is also Freight Train's number. Coincidence?
I have no idea.
Is that a good omen?
We'll see in the next 2 minutes, Bulldog, how this is going to play out. Lil Payne on the jammer line for Boston. And there has been a jammer swap out? Freight Train is back on the jammer line. I thought for a while, it could have been my eyes deceiving me. I thought they put Brandy Brown out there.
Well, now it is Freight Train out there in number 22, 22 points behind Boston. And Lil Payne, though, is jamming for Boston. So they were able to get their jammer out of the penalty box.
4 seconds remaining on the period clock. It is all about who gets lead jammer now.
That's right. And even if she gets lead jammer, Freight Train's work still cut out for her. She has to get at least 5 scoring passes just to tie Boston Massacre, but not doing it so far. Ginger Kid knocks her to the infield and now gets no pass, no penalty. But it's these
lead jammer.
Lead jammer.
No time on the clock, and she makes it big.
There it is. And that's all it takes. That's all Boston had to do. But hats off to Houston. How about that comeback in the second half?
That was an amazing comeback by Houston in the second half. They really put up a whole bunch of points. We had them coming into the second half with only 48 points, so they put up 108 points on the board this second half. Boston starting the second half with 115, only moved to 179. So Houston the winner of the second half, but the Boston Massacre truly the winners of this bout.
All right, but Houston showing that they are indeed number 28 in the WFPD. Only 4 places right now ranks behind Boston, who they just faced. That actually turned out to be a pretty epic bout, a pretty epic second half at least, especially for Houston. And a lot of drama, too, with that, especially with that last hit, that penalty box served by Anorexia when she had just gotten injured. That had to be, Boston must have gotten a a little bit shaken by that. A little bit of doubt might have crept into their mind.
I was glad that they stayed on the penalty bench, though. Clearly, Onyarex, it was okay to continue the bout down there. So good news there that Boston, of course, having another bout tomorrow, and Houston also facing off again tomorrow. So more derby for both these teams tomorrow. It's important that we don't have key jammers like Onyarex getting hurt here.